Greetings. My name is Kathy Gutierrez, and it is my great honor to introduce my colleague and friend, Massimo Introvigni, our second keynote speaker. Massimo's list of accomplishments is far too long to even begin to make a dent in here. So suffice to say that he has published more than 80 academic books, and I have not yet found a bad one. His most recent is on the Plymouth Brethren. That's the first monograph on this group. It's a small conservative evangelical group about which he has told me there is nothing in common with this conference except for the fact that Aleister Crowley's father was a member. And I'm pleased to be able to tell you that because in a rare moment of a bad decision, Oxford University Press decided to take that part out, so you'll only hear it here. So Massimo is currently the director of CESNR, the Center for the Study of New Religions, and he's the founder in 1988. Yeah, 88. So that has been a colossal undertaking. He's also taught in many places. And just on a personal note, it has been my pleasure that he spent a great deal of the last year in New York, where I currently live. And I had the pleasure of being invited to their beautiful and gracious home for a Christmas party where I got a tour of some of the most remarkable esoteric art I've ever seen.
My job today is to give you a general overview of sacred sexuality in contemporary Western esotericism and its roots, which are not only in the West. So my presentation tonight will have four parts: the central concept of sacred sexuality, three roots, three main techniques, and four contemporary examples. Although for the sake of being slightly less generic, I would focus on the lesser known group in the US, but perhaps better known in Europe, which is MISA. And the choice is also for a reason of size. It's a group with tens of thousands of students or practitioners. Now, everybody knows here that the central concept or one of the first concepts for defining esotericism is a theory of correspondences, as above, so below. And in his 1976 book, also very much well known, Occultism, Witchcraft, and Cultural Fashions, Mircea Eliade insisted that in a typology of correspondences, a very important correspondence is between spirit, light, and semen. Semen generates children in the microcosm of the woman, but by means of some techniques, many of them kept secret, the semen may be transformed into energy, give you spiritual enlightenment, and even makes it possible to generate immortality. So what are the roots of these teachings? A first root is Chinese Taoism, dating back to the 3rd century BCE, and already Chinese alchemists, who may have claimed to be the first, were teaching that the sperm contains yin, or vital energy, and that the most appropriate way of taking advantage for your enlightenment of this qing is to preserve rather than wasting it. So they started talking about intercourse without ejaculation, which was later called in the West male erotic continence. Unless you believe it was only the usual patriarchal gaze on women, Chinese insisted that will also benefit the female partner. Now, these teachings are surely very old in China, and here and there, travelers and scholars visited China and hinted at the existence of these techniques, but for a complete presentation in the West, we had to wait until the 1970s, when Chinese or other Asian teachers came to the West. The second route is Tantra, and here we heard a lot in this conference about Tantrism, and it goes without saying that Tantrism is a contested category. Particularly Indian scholars would sometimes claim it's an Orientalist category. It has been actually invented by Westerners who tried to superimpose their Western mind on creating a system that never was. There was no system of Tantrism, but of course they were Tantras. Books conceived and written in India by Hindus, by Buddhists, by Jains, roughly between the 5th and the 12th century CE. And what did the Tantras have in common is that they see material reality as a resource. You know, some Buddhist texts would call material reality an obstacle to enlightenment, but the Tantra saw material reality as a resource. Now, by no means in the Tantra the only material reality is sexuality. That's a caricature of Tantra, but sexuality is included. And among the resources you can find sperm, and you can find menstrual blood, urinary fluids, and whatnot. Now, Tantra, like its Chinese counterpart, also taught continence, but on the other hand, there was a left-hand so-called Tantra path, which was teaching something else. And that was using the sperm without keeping it, and using it through assimilation. And assimilation meant ingesting the sperm or being anointed with the sperm after different forms of producing it. In order to transform it into energy. Now, what continence and assimilation had and have in common is their effectiveness is posited on the theory of chakras. They had to go up from the lower chakras to the upper chakras, but in continence, the force sending the sperm up is created by not ejaculating, while in assimilation this force should be created with other techniques. And here you see Arthur Avalon, pseudonym of Sir George Woodruff, was so important. I read recently Kit Cantu's article about the Bengali connections of Arthur Avalon was so important in making the Tantras known in the West. Now, the third roots are not Eastern, but are Western and are part of the traditions of Western esotericism, but they are much more hidden. Because as we saw again in many papers, people try not to talk as explicitly as the Indians or the Chinese about sexual techniques. So there is an old debate, I'm afraid, I started 20 years ago, where hidden in some very obscure text of Cagliostro is really a system of sex magic. He talks about a certain wild thing, which to me may well be the sperm, but not having interviewed Cagliostro, I cannot say for sure it looks like, but I'm not judgmental of other scholars who disagree. And also, we saw again in this conference, I don't need to insist here, how early spiritualists, they really had sexual practices, but they were very afraid of talking. So you have to navigate through allusions and metaphors in order to figure out what they were doing. I believe in this room we have a paper about William Butler Yeats and the first wife. They are doing very interesting things, but to reconstruct them is difficult because they wrote them down in a very cryptic way. Now, people who started talking freely about certain sexual techniques were not completely unrelated to esotericism, but also came from different traditions. In 1848, in Oneida, New York, John Humphrey Noyes founded the first Western community centered on continents and also in the exchange of partners, which lasted for about 33 years. Gordon Melton here attracted the attention on the importance of women, showing again that sexual magic or magic eroticism was never a purely male project. And Melton again discussed figures such as Amy Stockham or Ida Craddock. Stockham developed a system called Carezza, which was a male-female version of continence, and Craddock founded her own organization called Church of Yoga. But Craddock was repeatedly arrested for her sexual teachings. She didn't like it in jail, and in 1902, faced with the prospect of going to jail again, she committed suicide. Rosicrucian, modern Rosicrucian groups also applied erotic continence to their system and other teachings, including assimilation of sperm. A leading figure in the field of Rosicrucian sex magic was Pascal Beverly Randolph, who was an American mulatto, Rosicrucian, who had connection with the mysterious Hermetic Brotherhood of Luxor, but also an influence on a much larger theosophical milieu, as those who read the books of Pat Deveny about Randolph and the Hermetic Brotherhood of Luxor will learn. We should mention, if in passing, the extraordinary Chevalier de Saint-Marc. Saint-Marc was not a crazy guy only. He was an important theosophist and spiritualist leader in Belgium. I remember I discovered it in the Royal Library in Brussels and told to a young man called Marco Pasi how it would be worthwhile to study this guy, and Pasi produced a beautiful article about Saint-Marc, even interviewed the last members of his family. Really nice job. Now, Setmark went from controversial to notorious when he published anonymously, but he was discovered soon, a pamphlet in 1906 called L'Eucharistie, in which not only discussed assimilation, which he called spermatophagy, but he also claimed that Jesus Christ was practicing spermatophagy. Well, this is my body, what is this? And also that the Catholic Church kept the practice of spermatophagy in secret. So he called the Catholic mensongistes, people spreading lies because they were not explaining what the priests were doing in secret, and launched a periodical called the Censoriste, spreading the truth. And the truth was that the Catholic Church was still practicing spermatophagy, which made him ruin the spiritualist and Masonic leaders. He was expelled from almost all possible esoteric organizations. And here you see the only picture with, of all people, Sir Arthur Conan Doyle, conference I have found of him. Now, we saw the three roots, Taoism, Tantra, Western esotericism. Let's now discuss or summarize the main techniques. First technique is continence. And continence is not skipping the orgasm. On the contrary, it's multiple orgasms without ejaculation, which should be called male continence. But then there are female versions in which women are taught how to reach various orgasm states without discharge. Don't tell me how I do it, not a woman, and it seems not easy. Then there is assimilation, and assimilation is also very old. As I say, that's the ingestion or anointing with semen, spermatophagy that was mostly Saint Mark, at times mixed with other stuff, female secretion, but we will see it can be mixed with non-sexual products as well. And then there is the esoteric ritual use of urine, sometimes named or codenamed golden elixir, and sometimes of menstrual blood, again through drinking or anointing. Now, time will not allow to discuss many traditions practicing sexual magic. I will discuss, however, some of them. We had several sessions about OTO, but no paper, I believe, about Karl Kellner this time. Karl Kellner was a wealthy German industrialist, and he had some real knowledge of Tantra. He traveled to the East, and he was of a different social class in the last ESVE conference in Erfurt. There was a paper about Karl Kellner showing his luxury home and personal trainer, which is something looking as a crossover between Samson and Tarzan. And of course, people like Theodore Royce could not afford this. So it was of a different social background, but he met Theodore Royce, discussed in the last session I attended. It was a different character. He was probably both a socialist and a spy of the police, spying on the socialists at the same time. And he had a keen interest in the practicalities of both heterosexual and homosexual sex men. I will not trace here the foundation of the OTO, which is a very controversial subject, but as everybody knows, at one stage the main branch of the OTO came under the control of Aleister Crowley. and which not everybody liked. And so pre-Crowleyan OTOs also continued and exist to this very day. Now, Crowley, well, the pre-Crowleyan OTO before Crowley, and then the Crowleyan OTO, developed various sex magic techniques, and we saw this morning in this room Richard Kaczynski with a wonderful statistics, how to make good use of statistics. He counted all the sexual operations of Crowley from his journal. That's what statistics should be all about. So Crowley didn't only do it frequently, but he elaborated a very serious theology about divine role of the sperm. Sperm is actually God in this world, and this God can be made to enter our life, but Crowley had no passions with continence, so his way was assimilation in the form of ingestion. Although at one stage he also sold the pills of Amrita, which you can use in many different ways, which included his own sperm. But his main way was ingestion after both heterosexual or homosexual lovemaking, in some cases together with the female secretions, and he believed that was an extremely effective magical technique, and also it was sustained by what for sure can be called a religion. If Oneida was the first experiment centered on continents, the Abbey of Telema in Cefalù, Sicily, founded in 1920, was the first community based on sex magic and sperm assimilation. The Abbey was closed by Mussolini's police in 1923, and it still exists, but in a state of disrepair, and I sign petitions from time to time to save it, but it's in private terms, and that's not easy. Now, today, the main branch of the OTO, which also includes some academics in organizations called OTOA, OTO Academic, has some 3,000 members throughout the world. And recently, I was a speaker during the Turing Book Fair introducing a book by Marco Pasi on Pessoa's documents concerning to Crowley, translated into Italian, and it's interesting. We agreed in the end that it was the sexual revolution that allowed, after 68 and in the 70s, Crowley to be rediscovered by the academia. But sure, but now Crowley is taken very seriously in the academia, and also his activities as an artist. His paintings are actually by Crowley, not to mention the artists like Schultz Solar he influenced, and as a poet also generated considerable academic interest. Crowley was not a satanist. I spent considerable and perhaps unnecessary time to try to clarify this point. He believed Satanists were inferior Christians, because to be a Satanist you have to accept that the Bible is true, and in this case Crowley say you have already lost, because you have already conceded to the Christians the main point. So he was not a Satanist, and he didn't accept the Judeo-Christian narrative of the devil. But what is true when a connection between Crowley and Satanism is alleged is Crowley was not a Satanist, but many Satanists are Crowley. We cannot blame this on Crowley, Nicholson, but Satanists use a variety of techniques derived from Crowley, but the theologies or anti-theology or demonology is completely different. Now let me come to the second group, which was very important in the history of Italian 20th century esotericism, but not a big deal outside of Italy. And this is the competing esoteric orders tracing their origin to Giuliano Kremers. Now, Giuliano Kremers was successful, I don't know, without the pseudonym would have been successful, because Ciro Formisano evoked selling pizza in Naples. Giuliano Kremers may evoke madness. So he was successful, and he founded something he called the Brotherhood of Miriam, whose inner circle, which may have pre-existed Kremers, was called the Egyptian Order of Osiris. And there are still several hundred members in many branches, 10, 11, 12. But the problem about Kremers, again, Kremers is a very controversial subject among scholars of Western esotericism, or contemporary Western esotericism, because the teachings in the fascist Italy were kept a secret for obvious reasons, but they were kept so secret when they started being published, we don't know whether they are genuine or not. And each group has different versions, and would the real Kremers please stand up? But that doesn't work, because there are not enough manuscripts to give it a call and say this group has the genuine teachings of Kremers. So we really don't know. But so it's, I would say, the main system, but I would not bet it's the exact system Kremers was teaching during his lifetime. And it's not very fun to be a member of a Kremers group, because you need to abstain from any sexual activity for very long periods, between one operation and the other, and also the times of abstinence are based on astrology. And astrology may call for quite long periods of abstinence. But before completing your journey to enlightenment, and much more than enlightenment, to immortality in Kremers system, you have to pass through three stages. The first degree operation is ingestion of sperm, but no intercourse. You obtain the sperm through masturbation, that's the way for men, and for women, you should masturbate during your red days and then ingest your blood charged by masturbation. The second degree involves lovemaking, and then you collect some sperm and female secretions, and you ingest them. And the third degree has three sub-degrees, because that's the ingestion of the same mixture, but it's obtained through three different intercourses. There is l'œuvre au noir, the black work, that's anal sex, l'œuvre blanc, the white work, that's the it's without ejaculation, but that only charges a mixture you have obtained before, and then you ingest it. And then there is l'œuvre au rouge, and that's intercourse during the women's red days, so that all gets mixed with menstrual blood. Now, there is is a secret part, or the most secret part, in Kremlin's operation, which what we have just seen is not all the story. Actually, in order for enlightenment to be achieved, or immortality, you have to mix the mixture of male and female secretion with what Kremlin called the ferment. Only nowhere did he reveal what the ferment was. So some may say it's the egg of a whale or the egg of some other strange animal, and the different groups experiment with eggs of different birds to be mixed with the elixir or the mixture. Come to a third group, which we start meeting groups with thousands of members, and that's the Gnostic teacher of Samael Aun-Weor. Now, in order to understand Samael Aun-Weor, we should go back to Arnold, or Arnoldo, as he called him after he moved to South America. Krumheller was an associate of Royce, he knew Crowley, but he was also a communist, and he moved to Latin America, where he believed there were more opportunities for communist political activities. And all Krumheller groups throughout Latin America more or less have a teaching of sacred sexuality or sex magic. But among the students of Krumheller, one was a Colombian called Victor Manuel Gomez Rodriguez, or Samael Aun-Weor. In 1950, 1 year after Krumheller died, Weor founded in Mexico the Universal Gnostic Church. As happens in all such movements, there are dozens of schisms, but through the schisms, the Weor movement maintains thousands of members throughout the world. No. Did something very wrong. Okay. Now, their second sexuality system is a system of continent. Actually, he believed Crowley and other teachers to be part of a black lodge, to be very bad people, to say the least. Because in order to become enlightened, you have to avoid ejaculation, and only through this the semen and even the female secretion is physiologically complicated, may be transmuted and passed to higher octave, and the musical language comes from Gurdjieff. And with this continuous operations of transmutation, you end up building a marvelous and strong astral body, which is your personal ticket to enlightenment and also spiritual immortality. It's very clear that in many Weor groups, common people does not have an immortal soul. You need to build your immortal soul. It's for the happy few. They know the techniques, and through the techniques you can really build the soul. All the others will simply disappear. It's very Gurdjieffian in a way, again. I would now come to my last part, where I would say something more about the largest group of sacred eroticism today, which at its peak had 40,000 members, and is called MISA, the Movement for Spiritual Integration into the Absolute, which is founded by a Romanian teacher called Grigorian Bibolaru, you see here, and teaches a form of tantric yoga derived from tantric Shivaism or Kashmir Siddha yoga tradition of Tamil Nadu. But again, there is a lot of discussion, particularly among opponents of the movements, whether they references which are normally books written by Western esotericists are the best possible books about these traditions or not, but Bibolaru surely did a lot of homework, even in communist Romania, and reading books about Tantra. Bibolaru was born on March 12, 1952 in Tărtășești, in the Romanian region of Muntenia. His official biographies claim he experienced altered states of consciousness already as a young boy. Certainly, he developed an early interest for yoga. For instance, he wrote to Eliade, which was not very safe in communist Romania, and got an answer. At age 18, 1970, he started teaching yoga in Bucharest. That was the time of the Ceausescu regime. But yoga was not entirely forbidden. It was sort of a stop-and-go situation. If you claim your yoga was non-spiritual, just well-being technique, you can get away with it, but not always. No. From 1972 on, Bibolaru was arrested several times. He was suspecting wrongly of being the Romanian leader of transcendental meditation. And finally, in 1989, that was the end of the Ceausescu regime, he was committed to the psychiatric hospital in Poggiana Mare, which was a very feared place, and where a number of dissidents also ended up. But that lasted happily for Bibolaru just a few months, because the regime fell, Ceausescu was killed, and Bibolaru was freed from the psychiatric hospital. And he could start again in a post-Ceausescu Romania to teach yoga, and as a matter of fact, in 1990 founded his own movement, MISA, the Movement for Spiritual Integration into the Absolute. And that was phenomenally successful. It got from to 40,000 members, 750 full-time, and this phenomenon probably happened because this esoteric yoga, which included a positive appreciation of sexuality and love based on continence, was perceived by many young Romanians as a symbol of the new freedom after the Ceausescu era. And from Romania, the movement spread internationally in many countries: Austria, UK, Germany, France, Italy, Denmark, Sweden, Finland, Hungary, Czech Republic, Ireland, Bosnia, Slovenia, Norway, Cyprus, South Africa, Argentina, Uruguay, India, and Thailand, United States. There are some small groups. It's not, surely not one of the largest esoteric movements. And an international federation called ATMAN, the International Federation of Yoga and Meditation, was created to oversee the many national chapters. But of course, not everybody was happy in Romania about a group including teachings about sacred sexuality and a very liberal approach to sex. Opposition to cults survived communism, the Orthodox Church was not very happy, and from 1990 to 1993 there were continuous media campaigns against the sex guru. I remember in another conference I showed a title of a Romanian newspaper whose translation is Bibolar, the man who went to bed with 30,000 virgins, which seems difficult, and speaks a lot about virginity in Ceausescu Romania, it seems strange, nonetheless. So, this campaign escalated in what was nicknamed by the Romanian police Operation Christ, and for those of you who are more familiar with new religious movements, is the typical raid described by Stuart Wright and Susan Palmer in their book Storm in Zion. Police arrives at 4 in the morning with more weapons than would be needed for a peaceful group. A lot of media also come, and the bad guru is arrested, and the good citizens are reassured of the full protection of the law. And eventually everybody was found not guilty except Bibolar for a special story, but that didn't destroy the movement. From 40,000 students, they went to the 29,000 perhaps today, but the number of full-time members increased outside Romania, so it's now higher than it was in 2004. And that it's a large movement can also be guessed from the two large meetings they do in Romania. In Romania they are not banned. Even Bibolar stayed for some time in jail, is not wanted in Romania. And they do two large yoga camps in May and in August, and you see 5,000, 7,000, 10,000, which gives the impression of a substantial movement. Now, Misa teaches a large variety of techniques, from alchemy, enneagram, communication with angels, and whatnot. They call it unity in diversity, and trying to find the esoteric inner part of all teachings. But there is little doubt that tantrism is the key part. There are Vira, tantric men, for tantric groups for men, Shakti, tantric groups for women. Now, one thing surely Misa and Bibolar teach is continence. And they offer seminars on the secret tantric path of love, whose key is teaching continence, orgasm without ejaculation, as a great transformative force. They also teach other things. For instance, that's very beautiful, it's called the young yogic spiral. When people who go to the camp, they are distributed according to their astrological sign, and then they rotate, and by doing this exercise, supposedly the astrological effect of the beneficial astrological effect of a ruling planets is actually amplified. Also, they teach and devote considerable time to what they call objective art, which is visual arts, dance, theater, which should also express the initiation through force and code. But again, the center is male continence, which also benefits the woman, and not unlike Veor, they regard other forms of sacred sexuality, particularly assimilation, as deviate and dangerous, and not consecrating lovemaking to God. So they teach only continence. Not only, because they also teach the use of urine based on Indian text called Damar Tantra. And the basis is that the practice of yoga, continence, vegetarian diet, improved the quality of urine. So the first thing you do, they are not the only one to do this, you drink your own urine and you amplify qualities you already had. But what some Indian roots to is the connection between urine and astrology. And so they also have another practice where you assimilate or drink or anoint yourself with the urine of a partner of a different astrological sign. Actually, in one of their practice, a male student drinks the mixed urine in a cup of women of all the different astrological signs in order to achieve an androgynous status and unification with these women, but also assimilate their astrological qualities of all the different signs. Now, a controversial part of Mises' activities are in the movies. Some students of Mises, rather than the movement per se, experimented in the 1990s with adult movies. They wanted to bring their witnesses in the world of adult movies. It didn't work out very well, but the principal movie director, a lady called Carmen Gnace, now goes under the name Agoravidia, put this experience to good fruit because after some more than 10 years from the, after some years, should check the exact dates from the erotic movies, she started with movies for a different audience. Actually, in Latin America, where they are made, they are rated, you cannot watch them if you are under 14, but if you are between 14 and 18, you can watch. So it's still movies about sexuality, but they are not in any way adult movies. And the most recent movie by Gnace, it's a very interesting movie, which is called Las Caras de la Diosa, Faces of the Goddess, and really it closes her giving and receiving with pornography, because we have two pornographic characters, very famous, Hino and Luz, and they are losing not only their motivations, but even their physical ability to perform, so they are almost ruined, and then they discover continence, and that changes their life completely. They even persuade their old director of the pornographic movies to do a movie about continence. And first they refused, said that nobody would see it, but in the end, in the final scene, he won the Festival of Cannes, first ever erotic movie about continence. So now you will see the trailer.
Estás al borde de perder tus propias fuerzas.
¡Empezamos!
¡Oh, muy bien!
Si queremos seguir en primera fila, tenemos que conducir High Quality 4.
¡Gio!
She's a famous Argentinian model, but she's also a member of this.
¿Y cuál es la diferencia?
Necesito un descanso. Esto acá. ¡Ya caduco! ¿Vos te crees hombre?
Vendes tu alma como un porcelana. ¿Qué estás prostituyendo?
¿Quién sos? ¿Quién sos?
Sí, la diferencia. Naciste sin este cuerpo. Para conocer el perfume sublime del amor sagrado. Debe ser tequila.
sacred love means continence. Do it without ejaculation. Now, as I said, Misa's many enemies, particularly in the Romanian media, but sometimes in other countries as well. So they insist, and rightly so, that they teach about a variety of arguments. They offer 2100 courses, only 100 or less refer to sexuality. But in this age and time, what the media are interested in is sexuality. The rest is not very sexy. So there is a complicated web of legal actions involving Misa. Bivolaru was arrested, escaped to Sweden, got political asylum there, had a very bad idea of traveling to France, where cultists are not exactly loved, where he was arrested and sent back to Romania. But he was freed in Romania for humanitarian reasons, but he's not very young, but other countries are still have some quarrels with him. And apart from the technical legal details of his case, I believe the impopularity or notoriety of Bivolaru in Romania derives from the fact that he preaches a worldview where sexuality and religion are not separated. Because of course you can say, okay, some students of Bivolaru did adult movies, but Romania is a mecca for these movies. And Romania is also a place supplying the rest of Europe with prostitutes very often. So that shouldn't be a big scandal. So where is the scandal? The scandal is in putting together religion and sexuality. If you keep them separated, there is no law and no scandal in doing erotic movies or erotic shows or teaching some sexual techniques. But if you call them a spirituality or religion, at this stage there is a reaction by society and you end up in jail. And also the fact that this group is not one of these sex magic groups with 100, 200 members, but they had 40,000 was in itself a big scandal, because it started being a force to reckon with in Romanian society. In conclusion, why people join groups promoting sacred sexuality? And some of these groups have tens of thousands of members. If we ask the tabloid media from the time of Aleister Crowley, as you see, why people join sex magic groups, the answer is to have fun and to find readily available young and sexy partners. But that's not the full story, and perhaps it's not even the story. I have studied the sacred sexuality groups for 30 years, and I would say it's almost never true, because if you focus on these techniques, you don't have a lot of fun. And in some cases, as I mentioned it, the people told me of very long periods of chastity to prepare for the sacred sexual operations. So if they were out for very frequent sexual encounters, they probably picked up the wrong group. If we go back to Taoist and Tantric sources, we also see that it was not about fun, because early China and India were very rich of prostitutes, so fun was readily available, but what was not readily available was a training for a spirituality involving the body and sexuality. So the real doctrine, the real reason people went there, and the real reason people go there is immortality. And as I mentioned before, most of these groups, perhaps not all, teach that not all humans are truly immortal. Not all of us have a soul, certainly not an immortal soul. And we have to build our body of immortality, and it's a tough work. But the body of immortality and the mortal body are built with the same raw material, a sperm and a female component. If you want to produce a children, that's what you need. But if you want to produce an inner children in the form of a body of immortality, these are the same raw material. Now, some groups today will say you also gain some very practical advantages. You practice sexual magic, and you can achieve, if not physical immortality, a very long life. In this book, here is a guy who claims to be 250 years old. So you can, if you are interested in this, short of becoming a vampire, as we discussed, that we will discuss in another session tomorrow, you can practice some of these Chinese techniques or Tibetan and hope to live up to 250 years old. But for most people, it's not physical immortality, it's spiritual immortality. And immortality never goes out of fashion. And if traditional religion seems to become secularized and this worldly, talk less about immortality, there are other groups which offers immortality. Of course, there are new religious movements also talking a lot about physical immortality, but sacred sexuality also sometimes claims to be a science, and technique of immortality. We teach you how to become immortal, and it's not a religion, it's science, and its technique. So don't go to search for immortality in the traditional religions, because they are out-fashioned in the time of science, but we are part of science. So we can teach you how to become immortal. And of course, as Beard said in my previous quote, immortality is something many people will die for. Thank you. Yes. Am I self-moderating or can
I
jump in?
Claire.
Yeah. So thank you. That was really interesting. I am very struck at the differences in numbers between the OTO, you gave it that 3,000, I think, and 30,000 for MESA. And obviously, the MESA group has a lot of resources at their disposal. They're enormously popular comparatively. And I wondered if you could sort of analyze the difference. Like, why do people flock in 10 times the numbers to MESA? And is it to do with, would you say, with the immortality promise, which I guess, or is there something?
Well, I believe it's structural and sociological. The OTO is an esoteric order. So esoteric orders, unless you are the Amor, but that was something different. Normally esoteric orders don't have the same ways of proselytization as new religious movements. And MESA is much more structured like a new religious movement. So they actually organize their worldwide expansion and proselytization as NRMs do. So in this sense, MESA is about esotericism, but it's not an esoteric order. So it's not elitistic. It doesn't talk about the happy few like esoteric orders do. Now, not that the OTO doesn't like to have more members, but their ways of growing limit the possibilities of growth, while the MESA was always an expanding group with the typical techniques of new religious movements, pamphlets, presences and fairs. If anything, they also went to the sex fair, which was unusual for new religious movements. A lot of internet activity and YouTube and social networks. This is very common in the field of new religious movements, but it's not so common in the field of esoteric corners such as the OTO or the Giuliano Kremer's group. In some South American countries, the real competition is VEOR. And VEOR groups are extremely fragmented. Misa had some schisms, but not very large, and the founder is still alive. The VEOR groups also have several thousand members, and they also expand, well, they call themselves churches often, and they expand with the same methodology of new religious movements too.
Jeffrey. The subject of immortality that's prominent in Taoist practice in China, people have studied the life expectancy of immortality practitioners, and it's the same as everybody else, so I don't mean to discourage people, but that's the only objective information we have.
Well, I know Catherine Despeux, probably you know her too. Catherine Despeux is a French academic who spent several years training with in Chinese alchemy with Buddhist and Taoist nuns in China. And of course she didn't become immortal, but she claims she wrote a couple of books, she got some beneficial effects for her health. But if you read her books, she also says she became much less feminine and more androgynous through these practices.
I know, but I won't comment on the last.
Or you probably wouldn't like the side effects.
Keith?
I'm sorry. You include, these are nearly all Eastern yogic oriented things. What about all the burgeoning Kabbalah groups? Would you consider them new religious movements?
Yeah, I and Gordon Melton and Holly are studying neo-Kabbalah groups in Israel and elsewhere. I won't say that the largest neo-Kabbalah group do not particularly insist on sexual teachings. They may say that if you are a good Kabbalist, that would also benefit your intimacy, but there is not a specific sexual teaching in the largest groups.
Well, there's a very common teaching in Hasidic Judaism that sex on Shabbat is a sacred act, and one of the things I've stumbled over recently is, along with that, some Hasidim say you don't have sex any other time than Shabbat while you're keeping the laws of marital purity. But Jews are so blood phobic, you will never see something like this in Kabbalistic.
Or perhaps you did in the Middle Ages or early modern times,
more
or less hidden, but not in groups like the Bnei Baruch or the Kabbalah Center. You don't see this today. It's much more focused on the spiritual aspects of Kabbalah.
Did you have
I have two, and one I'll ask you privately over drinks sometime. But the question I have is the way that science is understood here, and it's kind of picking up something I was thinking about through your whole talk. And just as an observation, when I think about how esoteric people and alternative spiritual people talk about science, I think that they take a very 19th century conception where science is systematized knowledge. And so spiritualism can be scientific, and all sorts of things can be scientific. But my question is, this is all popularized during a time when science takes on a much larger role in our society. And so I'm intrigued by the fact, you guys are gonna get mad at me because I'm not an esotericist. This is an incredibly anti-modern movement. Everything about the fluid exchange, there's something that is deliberately anti-scientific and anti-modern about it. At least that's how I respond to it. And so I wonder if you'd speak a little bit further about how science is handled.
No, I believe you have here a valid point that it's largely 19th century science. Remember in Golden Dawn, and there was a guy called Dr. Berbridge. He was a medical doctor, and he also talked about carezza or continents. So in 19th century science, the idea that continents were very beneficial for your earth, I don't know if it was mainline science, but it can be sold as part of
it's like proprietary healers.
Of science. Yeah. But of course, the 20th century science is something different. And there are very different attitudes also. I struggle sometimes with some groups which keeps telling me, oh yeah, there is no religion, there is no spirituality, there is no esotericism, it's all science. So I say, if it's all science, I'm not interested. So they call me back, perhaps there is some spirituality. But other groups insist less. So I would say that Bimolaro would probably acknowledge it's not all part of science, but also it comes from Tantra, from European mysticism, and from other groups, but some other groups would say it's science.
You mentioned again a moment ago about the Middle Ages, and one of your earlier slides, I think, indicated that sacred sexuality could be evidenced in the West by the late medieval period. What's the earliest reference you know of that seems definitive as
There is very few which is definitive here, but you can imagine that some of the Rosicrucian texts in Germany in the 17th century had allusion to sexual systems, but again there is no 100% proof of it. But of course during the Renaissance, that's not my field at all. I just read the stuff of other worthy scholars who have experience in Renaissance magic, and they told us that there were hidden somewhere techniques about the sacred use of sexuality even in the Renaissance and perhaps even earlier. But only in the West this river is much more karstic or going underground. It seems in Chinese or Indian text it's stated in so many words because probably the context allowed to write it down more easily than it was the case in the West.
Okay, so quick follow-up. Does that mean that you either would not characterize this chronophagy of alleged Gnostic groups as a sexual practice, or do you not buy that they actually did that?
Yeah, as I say, if we talk about, again, it's not my field, but if we talk about the spermatophagy of the spermatognostics, we only know this through the accusation of the church father, so we don't know for sure, but surely if they practiced it, most probably was something similar. It was not just because they were degenerate people. But again, I'm a little bit out of my field, and here there are real experts of ancient Gnosticism.
Gentlemen, yes.
One thing that happens very often, though, is once you have a heresiological body of literature, that tends to perpetuate the ideas in the practice, because as soon as you know what you're not supposed to do, then you know that you can do it.
Absolutely.
yes, Jeffrey, then Claire.
Almost no one agrees with what I'm going to say, so I'd like your comment. I always have the feeling of these things that a great amount of the sex practices are actually fantasy or done very rarely. I'm not questioning sexo-resto, which is a plausible sort of thing, but ingesting all these fluids, and some of the strange positions, this sort of thing. I think there's a strong element of fantasy in this. I mean, you can say that about other aspects of esotericism, but I wonder what you think about that.
I don't believe it. I mean, I did, in my youth day, participant observation in some Kremers groups, and they had a hard time not to drink what they were producing and offering to me. So they really do. And even they place stretch even stranger things, perhaps hazardous for your health, like sulfur in their mixtures. So I believe they do, and I believe Crowley did too. Here we have Richard's biographer of Crowley. I believe it really was ingesting sperm. It was not a metaphor.
Yeah, so I just had a little bit of a linked point when you were talking about what medieval evidence is there. And I thought of this when you had actually the images from Cremorne, because they're very alchemical. In late medieval alchemical diagrams, you get a lot of very explicit sexual, in fact, I was just this short of using an alchemical image for the poster for this conference, because there's a lot of weirdly gendered bodies and explicitly sexual activity that you see. And they also, in alchemical texts, you find the use of bodily fluids as well. You find, in fact, there's a really remarkable image of a menstruating woman with the blood actually flowing out of her vagina. They're getting the bodily fluids from somewhere if they're using them in alchemy. Now, alchemical writing is obviously very coded, but there's definitely a sexual aspect to it. So, I mean, I would say that that's evidence of a sort for late medieval practices that are definitely envisioned in sexual terms and that are involving actual bodily fluids.
No, thank you. I believe if we take Eliade, let's go back to the very beginning. Eliade tried to believe that this correspondence between spirit, light, sperm was pervasive in all human culture. So sometimes it generated movements and techniques, sometimes it didn't, but sometimes it did, but they remained hidden because of the social context. So if we believe Eliade, this correspondence, to be one of the basic correspondences, it will not be surprising to find it even in the European Middle Ages, or in Islam, which we didn't touch, but there are theories about Islam too.
Yes?
Yeah, I was curious if you were talking about whether or not some of these groups that you were discussing actually are doing these practices. I was just wondering if you suggested that there was a strong link to constructions of Tantra in South Asia, whatever that is. So if we're looking at so-called Tantra groups in Asia actually doing these practices and ingesting these fluids, and is there any kind of link or inspiration to more European groups that we're looking at?
I mean, again, you need a specialist of Asia, but surely if you look at books like by Yug Yurba, they got the Tantric teachings in India, and he would tell some of these things he actually saw with his own eyes, so like they are going on. In the West, I believe it's they are going on, and it's more or less these groups a matter of course that they are going on. And of course, continents is a different story, but because continents, surely there are online communities of people practicing continents and fighting very hard against those who say it's actually bad for your health. So you can go to the internet and find people who practice continents for many different reasons, some of them spiritual or esoteric, and some of them simply because they believe it's more healthy. Or you can have more orgasms if you are a boy, and you can spend the whole night rather than having to rest at some stage. There are many different reasons why continence is hailed, and another many different reasons why people are against continence. It actually damages your health rather than improving it. So the continence, I believe it started perhaps in the 19th century, but again, we'll need people like Holley to do another book on the history of continents. It's been discussed since Toledo, the discussion never stopped, whether continents is good or bad for you.
Yeah, since I'm an endocrinologist and I deal with sexuality issues, orgasm without ejaculation is because the semen goes into the bladder. And that can be caused by certain drugs, blood pressure drugs, and so on, and presumably by Kegel exercise to develop the pelvic floor muscles. So I don't think there's really a health issue. I mean, it might be a sign of a health issue, but it's not really retaining the semen, it's just those two different places. But these groups, I think, aren't aware of that. That's really what it is.
No, I mean, in the traditional Chinese and Indian, it will travel to your brain, which you may tell me you don't believe it. But in traditional Chinese and Indian techniques, it will travel through the chakras up to the crown chakra, and that's why it was supposed to be beneficial. But you are telling me, as an endocrinologist, you don't believe it.
Well, I understand that's the theory. What I mean is, in terms of an actual thing.
I understand completely.
You say it goes away anyway.
You know, everything goes away. But
yeah.
Well, one of the things that, you know, Claire just mentioned about the alchemical fluids, you know, so much of the alchemical imagery is based on pregnancy because it's the idea of the production of this child, the philosopher's stone. So it seems to me that many of these techniques are avoiding pregnancy, and they, I don't know if there's an element of that in terms of
continence is avoiding pregnancy for sure, but they would say there is a higher form of pregnancy because you actually generate a magical child, not a scrolly or it's as we learned today, we're trying to do, but you generate an inner child. The body of immortality in these techniques, of course, there are many meanings of inner child, but it's the inner child. So we would say rather than renouncing pregnancy, we take pregnancy to a more spiritual level. So we have pregnancy in a different way.
I was just thinking that there's an interesting inversion conceptual between the idea of continence and the idea of celibacy, because male celibacy at the root of Christian monasticism and Catholic priesthood, etc. But kind of it's the same thing, but that for a completely different purpose. Or do we mean by continence just having sex, but
going? About the celibacy, of course, Jeff Kripal just summarized his observations in a wonderful book I can just recommend. But I believe it's different, and the marketing technique, so to speak, is very different, no disrespect intended. Because if you get in touch with one of these 1,000 members group, they will tell you with continence your sexual life will actually improve. And I showed you the trailer of the movie, Las Caras de la Diosa, the faces of the goddess. These people, it's not celibacy, it's a wonderful experience. They were porn actors, but porn actors was a lot about ejaculations. In porn studies, they say without an ejaculation, there is no porn. But they were sad and spent and even not functioning properly. And at one stage they discover continence, and lo and behold, their sexual life becomes wonderful. So it's not about celibacy. On the contrary, perhaps you saw some of the posters, it's also about multiple orgasms. Because you can have a much longer sexual experience without ejaculation, or so they claim. Of course, critics of continence would say the real sexual experience involves ejaculation, but as I say, this discussion has been going on for at least two centuries. And so we can, it's perhaps a matter of, I'm a lot about aesthetic taste, so it's perhaps a matter of aesthetic taste. What you prefer, but surely it has very few to do with celibacy. It's actually advertised as great sex.
By the way, this having sex without ejaculation is an aspect of Asian hunting practice.
Yes,
yeah.
yes, of course. Now, another question is the transmission of the tantric practices to the West, which happens through many mediations. In these mediations, there is the question of authenticity. Here I can refer you to Walter Hanegraaff's discussion of authenticity, which is also a socially constructed category. And in esotericism, there is not such a thing as unadulterated authenticity, because authenticity in all traditions comes with creativity and arrangements and schisms and change. But sure, it's a worthy discussion which should involve us in a dialogue with scholars of Eastern spiritualities, speaking the local languages, and reading the local languages about how the tantras got transformed or changed when they traveled to the West.
All right, my friends, it is 5:30, and George had his hand up, so last question, please.
Okay. So you mentioned that Kremers never revealed the ferment, and so there are different practitioners experiment with different things. I think you mentioned rare bird eggs. What are some other examples of things people have tried in these groups as a ferment?
No, it's normally animal stuff. It's ferments or something in liquid form taken from the animal. And they fight between each other. And I don't know what is the truth. There is also a mythology about hidden archives, and I do believe in hidden archives up to a point. Sometimes the hidden archives are mythological archives, and the beauty of the mythological archives is they remain mythological. When you discover the mythological archives, perhaps they are less sexy than you believe them. So let the hidden archives stay hidden.
Well, may all of your hidden archives stay hidden. Thank you very much.